Hello, and today we're going to talk about Ajax as part of the introduction to JavaScript. This is presented by me, Abram Hindle. I'm at the Department of Computing Science at the University of Alberta, Edmonton, Alberta, Canada, planet Earth. If you want the slides, they're at webdoc.cs/Hindle1/2016, compute404-javascript-slides. Good luck on that one. All right, today we're basically talking about JavaScript just so that students in 404 can deal with Ajax. So what is Ajax? Ajax is asynchronous JavaScript and XML. It's basically client-side. It allows us to do requests from our browser without us, the person, specifying where to actually go. It's different than images and CSS because it's computer controlled. It's JavaScript basically querying another system in order to get requests. This basically allows JavaScript to make HTTP requests and interpret the results without redirecting the browser. It means we can stay on one page at one time. So, I'll try to show you an example right here. So, let's go. We'll go network, and we'll go to Twitter. Search.twitter. Alright, see what's happening now. So, we can see that Twitter has forced us to download quite a bit of stuff. Quite a lot of stuff. And now we can search for something. So, let's search for cats. Okay. Notice how this changed, the page changed, but we never really moved pages. We can still see our old traffic there. So that's kind of interesting. Okay. Let's go look at the latest stuff on cats. And we can see people are linking to beads of cats, all sorts of things. Okay. But do you see all these GET requests? Right? So we got JSON, and they're sending us actual HTML, which we're jamming back into the page. They're sending us JavaScript, sending us some add stuff, some more JSON and all that jazz. And we can see that there was a timeline update. So let's see. That timeline update, it says that there's 18 results. And we can see that there's 18 new results there. They actually return us this array right here. So let's see if we can get into that. The HTML items that they send are actually right here, which are kind of hard to see. So let's just see. So that's what we sent, and that's what we got back. But do you remember sending that? We did ask for tweets, and we'd ask for cats, but the response basically is that. And then you can see it asked for a bunch of the avatars and stuff. Then we can see another request happened, and they got 28 back, and then another request happened a few seconds later, and we got 40 back. So if I click the 40 results, we'll scroll down, and we see we got cats and ads and more cats and some cute cats, right? Even some videos, some avatars, what have you. Okay, this is all done with Ajax. So basically, Twitter is sending out requests. So if I click here, XHR, we can see that it is actually sending asynchronous requests. So it's making many requests on our behalf. So that's pretty neat. So it's actually the browser. And never did we change the page, because if I just go back to all, you can see that our original GET request to the root is right there. Right? So that's nice. Okay, so let's go somewhere else. Let's go to google.com. and then let's start searching for who is the best compute 404 professor, right? Okay, so let's click XHR, and you can see that there's many different searches. So if I show you the parameters, we can scroll through these. So it's as I'm typing, who is the best compute 404 professor, right? So lots of requests, and the response isn't a lot. It doesn't really like the JSON response, but anyways, we can see that Google is sending back JSON responses, and you can see different kinds of IDs as we go through it. You can also see that it's basically a quoted JSON right there. Okay, so we stay on the same page, and then we get numerous responses, and this is all done with AJAX. Okay, so AJAX, it stood for Asynchronous JavaScript and XML, but really we're using JSON there. What it does is it can be used to avoid presentation responsibility on the web service. The web service can simply give us text or data which we can interpret and show, and basically it allows JavaScript to make HTTP requests. The disadvantage is that history and back button tends not to work that well. The bookmarks don't really work well unless you use unless you use the anchor URI notation like that, and it's not always super portable in the browser, as well as AJAX can only be asked upon the same domain, so there's the same origin policy. So if you ever see something complaining about the origin changing or something like that, it's because you haven't told it explicitly that it can be queried across domains. Okay, so how do we do AJAX? Well, we use JavaScript. So here's a function, it's called getSomeJSON. It makes a new XML HTTP request. This allows us to do asynchronous, and then we open, and we say we're going to use the get method, and here's the URI. It's going to ask for some JSON, right? So if we copy this out, we copy this, we go over here, and then we go some JSON, we can see that this is a JSON file, right? Example JSON file. Okay, we go back here, that's going to be that URI, because this URI will be relative to here. Okay? Then, for this to work, we have to do a callback. And this callback is on ready state change equals a function. And now, basically, this function gets called back numerous times as the ready state changes. And once the ready state is equal to 4, we're actually finally done getting our HTTP request. Then we have to check the status to see if it's legitimate or not. Was it okay or was it not okay? If the status was 200, then we're good to go, and then we can alert something. Now, this just sets a callback. This just sets up the object to open using that method, that URI. And then this will finally send it, and it will send it asynchronously. So, let's go get some JSON alert. An example JSON file. It obviously worked. So it's returning us the contents of this one, right? That is showing up right there. So that's interesting. But that was hard-coded. So how do we make this more generic? Well, what we can do is we can give it a URL and a success callback. We do the same thing. We make an XML HTTP request object. We tell it to open using a get, the URL we provide, and then we say on state changed, once the state equals 4, then we're going to call the success callback with the response text of the request. So this object will actually hold the response at the very end. Notice how this function here doesn't return anything, because only the callback, the success callback, basically continuation, will get the response text itself. Okay? So that's how we can make it generic. So that's pretty handy. Okay? So you might be a little bit skeptical of it, so I'll copy that. And then I'll open up this, paste this in here, We got our function getJSON. I can go getJSON. I can go sum.json. And then the callback will be alert. And then it alerted it. You're like, okay, that's not amazing. I don't trust you. Well, I can give the callback console.log, and it should log it, which it didn't quite. So let's just try this out. Function e console.log e, and it, the example's not working for me. But if we simply alert it, we get it. See? But it's a little bit delayed. If we go to network, we can see that I asked for it multiple times. We can see what its response was. Okay, so that's kind of nice. Can I get anything from anywhere? So what if I ask for http://.org? There was an error. And what we see here is this cross-origin request block, same origin this avails. So we go back here, we'll see it's not the same origin policy, so that's problematic. Okay? So you can only really ask from your local domain. So I could actually ask I could ask for a different URI from the same domain. So I could ask for HTTP webdoccs ualberta.ca handle1 1.py test equals 1, do the same thing, and then we see that we get a whole web page back as the content. So that's kind of nice. Okay, so that's how it works. Let's do an example. So that's the sum.json. This is the generic, and now let's call upon the generic. So what we're going to do is we're going to call this, and we're going to make an interactive application. So we'll do a dynamic, we'll do a callback. So two callbacks you should learn about are window set interval and window set timeout. It lets you run a function after in a loop in an interval, and this one lets you run it after a period of time. So here's an example. Set interval, function alert, hello, 3000. So this is 3000 milliseconds. So try it yourself. One, two, okay. We click try it and then count to three. One, two, three, hello. So you saw that worked. So that's good. And it keeps doing it because it's set interval, right? It won't stop till we stopped it. So I'm going to get rid of that because that's annoying. So that's the set interval. You can also do set timeout. Basically, set timeout takes a function and a delay. So that's nice. Here's an example. You got a delayed alert. You set a timeout and does slow alert. So here, if I click show an alert after 2 seconds, one, two, there it is. Cool, eh? Pretty neat. And you can also clear the timeouts if you keep its return value. So that's nice. Alright, so we know that these things allow us to run code later, once or many times. So we want some code to run later, so we go myInterval equals window set interval function, get our date, get how many seconds are in our date, and modulus 3. So every second, we're either going to be 0, s will be 1 plus 0, 1 plus 1, or 1 plus 2. So that means we're going to ask for 1.json, 2.json, or 3.json. And we'll call our getJSON function, and we'll get our JSON out, and then we will replace the text of Ajaxy. Where was it? Sorry. We will replace the text of Ajaxy right here with whatever the content is. Okay? And we're going to do this every second. Alright. So let's start getting. And now we can see that this keeps updating. And we keep getting that. So that's interesting. So it's actually getting those three files. And I'll show you what those three files are. See? One, two, three. And pretty neat. And you see that they happen a second apart. And they only take 30 milliseconds. Okay, so that's pretty cool. Alright, so we'll go to the next slide. Now, you don't need to use my function. If you're using something like JSON or a jQuery, you can use getJSON. And then it'll return data to you and you can ask for the data message. So here's like pretty well the same code. Let's just look at the difference. Right? Instead of getJSON, it's $.getJSON. Okay? And they use message, right? So we're going to get that. I'm going to go start getting. So you're wondering, wait, what do you mean .message? Well, it's actually parsing the JSON for you. So what's happening is that if we go 1.json, we have this JSON and it's got a message in there. So what it's doing is it is going to the dot message. So it's parsing the JSON. So that's handy. If you want to parse JSON, you can call it JSON.parse or something like that. And I'm showing you the example here. So if you want to parse JSON, JavaScript comes out of the box with JSON.parse and JSON.stringify. JSON.parse parses text, a JSON text. JSON.stringify turns an object into a JSON string. So we got var object, we got food, food hot dogs, condiments, what kind of sausage we're going to have, like a wiener. And so we say for hot dog, change this text to the JSON stringify of object. Okay? So let's call it. Oh, and then parse the data, the text from hot dog, and replace sausage with it. So this is sausage, right? And then this is hot dog. Sorry. So I'm going to click it. And we can see here, if I zoom out, that that got changed to this JSON object. And this got changed to the object.sausage. So it actually JSON parsed it, right? So that new object was there. So that's pretty neat. So that means if we have code, right, we can go str equals, and we can go A is B, right? So there's our JSON object, but it's a string, right? If we ask for string.a, we don't get anything. So what if we go obj equals JSON parse string? Parse expected property or name. Alright, well let's go the other way. Let's give obj the JavaScript this. Okay, then let's go JSON stringify obj. Right? So we're using double quotes in this one, which was probably the problem I had. Alright. And then we can turn that object back from a string into an object just with parse, and we get our object back. So that's pretty neat. But what we'll find is they're not truly equal. They're not even equal. But they're, if I ask for its parse that object, we get it out. I ask for its A attribute. Its A attribute should be equal to object's A attribute. Pretty neat. Pretty useful. Okay. Now, so this is all copyright 2014, all that jazz. It's kind of interesting, but it seems kind of silly. The example was basically just stuff on a web server. It was just JSON files sitting around. So in the next little bit, I'm going to talk about how to do it with maybe an actual application. Hi, welcome back. This is Abram Hindle. We're going to live code some Ajax here. This is part of Introduction to JavaScript. So the Ajax we're dealing with is going to be this function, getJSON, takes a URL, takes a success callback, and then it gets an XML HTML request. It opens it, you go open ready state, and once it's ready, and once it says it's 200, we call a success callback. Otherwise, we alert that there was an error. Then we finally send it. So we're going to take this code, copy that. We're going to go back to Emacs, and we're going to go to our index.html, which is an HTML file, HTML tag with a head, Ajax example, a license, and then we got a body, right? Inappropriately indented, and now we're going to put it over here in the script thing, paste it in there, that's fine, and this will be served from a Flask program where we have our main route, which is called root civ hello, and it's the root, and it serves that index.html file, and also has another root called Ajax. So it should already be running. So let's go check it out. So it's running, it says Ajax example, and we have an endpoint called Ajax that returns basically some JSON. So that's interesting. Okay, so we want this to do a little bit more. We want to be slightly more dynamic. In fact, we want the page to continuously pull Ajax. So let's go back to index.html and let us go set interval, and then we give it a function, right? And I'm going to tell it to do it every second. And what this function is going to do is it's going to get JSON, and it's going to get our Ajax, right? And for now, I think what we're going to do is we're going to add that as content to this div over here. So I gotta go get that div document get element by ID. I'm going to go main. Then I'm going to go get JSON. And this function will get some text. And what we're going to do is we're going to go div dot text content equals text for now. Okay, so I'm going to save that. And we're going to go back here. And now it's running. You can see every second it's making another request. But it's returning something constant, so that's super boring. So let's make it not return something constant, right? Let's make it return something interesting. Right. So what we could do is we could make it return maybe like some kind of value from the operating system. Right? So we could go go import OS, and then we could, well, I'm not sure I totally remember. So we're going to go bpython, because I don't remember. I'm going to go import OS. I'm going to go OS system, and we only get that. So it's wrong, we should do subprocess, right? And then we go subprocess check output, and I can give it like some arguments, and then we get that. So that's really what we want. So let's try this command for now. So import subprocess. Get our process string is equal to subprocess check output. Then let's return that JSON string. Return it as a JSON object, and then let's go back to our browser. And we can see that it's getting different values every single time. So it is basically a dynamic app with the web server giving us really fun information. Now, I find this kind of boring, so we're going to change this. I'm going to just make that date, but I want to run something else. Now, I found this really neat command, which is going to be a total pain, and that one is... what this one does is really quite neat. If I go back here, I'll show you. Basically just lets me run top once, and you can see that it's very hard to record this. Okay, so what I'm gonna do is I'm going to gonna make run top. And it uses a neat technique for stripping ANSI characters by Zool from command line. Okay, so if I go, if I go bash runtop sh, it works. If I chmod it, +x runtop, and I go runtop, I get the same thing. That's kind of cool. Let's see if we can get the same thing out. So we're going to change this to date string. We're going to change this to top string. And then we're going to make, I'm going to change this, we're going to go top. I'm going to go top string. Save that. Go to our, there was an error. It doesn't look like it's multi. I messed something up. Top string. Oh, imagine that. I'm running the same command. So I'm going to go run top. And we can see it appears, and it still has stuff in there I didn't want. Which is annoying. But whatever. Okay, so there's run top. And I just want to see something. there's still some hex jump in there, chunk in there I don't like. Okay. Anyways, so we're running top, and it doesn't look very good. It looks like this terrible JSON printout. And that's just because we're printing out the JSON. So let's go to our let's go back to our index.html. And let's change this. Instead of just doing text content, let's make some new divs. So let's go div.date and div.top. Okay. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to go date div. I'm going to ask for the date. I'm going to ask for top div. Give me top. And now I'm going to parse the JSON. And now I'm going to go div date div or date div dot text content equals ob dot date, and then I'm going to go top dot div equals dot top. Okay, let's go back here. Let's restart this, and something's not working. Oh no, it's working. This looks bad. I don't like how this is laid out. It doesn't care about new lines. So I'm going to make it care about new lines. Let's change this to code. Change this to pre. There we go. So that's mostly working, except I have all this ugly stuff that I didn't fix. But nonetheless, I'm kind of seeing it there. And now basically, I have the top command. This command. Basically running there. Right? So that's kind of cool. This one's a little faster. This one's got a slower delay. Okay. Pretty simple. And I'm just moving stuff around. Okay. So it's not a ton of work, but it does work. Alright. So that's basically how we're doing AJAX. I just want to go back here. Let's go to network. And you can see that we're making lots of requests, and you can look at the response. Response has stuff in it shouldn't have, I thought was getting stripped out, but, you know, can't always be right. Okay, so I hope this was helpful to you. Feel free to ask questions in the forum. See you again for next time.